Good morning, Mr. Finney. How are
good
you?
Good morning, Leila. I'm
good
fine.
Morning.
Good morning, Ruben. Great interview with the very cerebral Dr. Kayode Fayemi.
That was a great
conversation. He has a PhD in war studies.
Yes.
And he has had significant political experience.
War studies. Oh, that's great.
Yes. Speaking on behalf of the governors, I'm sure there are many governors who couldn't have faced the fire from the door of Ruben and Leila.
Are we that bad?
Yes, you can be sometimes.
No, it was a conversation.
Yeah. Exactly, we have conversations.
It wasn't a conference.
Yes,
exactly.
you tried to calm him down. That it's not a...
he's not taking an exam.
That was good. That was a good little start. Yes, but let's start with the review. These day newspapers. Of course, the governors. Governors agree on 2-week lockdown in interstate movement. With 91 new cases, COVID-19 incidences rise to 873. Federal government bans interstate movement of COVID-19 patients for treatment. Await results of probe of Kano deaths attributes rising cases to aggressive testing. Task force to recommend review of lockdown to Buhari. 14-day isolation of Chinese doctors ends today. Aerofight test negative for virus. Yes, what the governors have agreed on to lock down interstate movement. I think Dr. Kayode Fayemi gave quite a vivid explanation of what it entails and how the... But my take is that couldn't this have been done earlier? Because I thought they were just meeting for the first time. But he said they've been meeting all this while, virtual meeting, as it were. But how come this decision did not appear earlier? Because at a point, some governors were saying their names are in the Bible. Or at one point, the northern governor was saying, no, we cannot lock down our state. Because, so what was the conversation that was going on before this last meeting?
But a governor like Seyi Makinde from my state, Oyo State, had actually put a ban on travel in and out of Oyo State prior to this meeting. So he's an example of a governor that actually did ban travel in and out of the state, except, of course, for necessary supplies, such as medical supplies, etc.
Better late than never, but I thought it could have been done much earlier.
I think the weak link in this regard is that many of the states, the governments were not firm enough.
Yeah.
There was curfew in many of the states. There was lockdown in many of the states. There was, the closing now of borders announced by many of the states. But the thing, of course, that they now discovered, which became an awakening for many of the state governments, is that persons were coming either from Lagos, in Kano, the Indus case traveled abroad and came, but there were other persons who came from Lagos at a point in a truckload, of persons that whose status could not be determined, they were turned back. Because at that point, Kano realized that people were coming from outside, and those persons could be COVID-19 positive. In the case of Ogun State, you will recall, some persons came from, Cote d'Ivoire? Through Republic of Benin.
Yes.
Now, Ogun State decided that this cargo cannot wait here because it's very suspicious cargo of persons of indeterminate COVID-19 status. Those persons said they were from Igbajo, and that was how Osun State ended up with its own index case. So these states, these various states have learned a number of lessons, and now they've decided that, look, one, just stay where you are. And Minister Ihanire, the Minister of Health, also added yesterday that if you are COVID-19 positive, you will be treated in the state of the incidence.
No,
you will not be allowed to move to another
state.
The only problem that I think we have with this, which the governors probably may not have addressed, is the decision by the governors to relax the lockdown in their states. Now, today, for example, with all the anxiety that we have been expressing the whole of this week about Kano, you know that the governor has relaxed the lockdown from, I think, is it 7 a.m. to 2 p.m. And now the excuse is that, people should go and stock up foodstuffs and stockpile foodstuffs for the beginning of Ramadan. So on the surface of it, it makes sense. But it's the same Kano state that has been expressing concern about people coming from other states and entering Kaduna and going in and out. Now, where is the weak link? Is it with enforcement. Maybe the governors have to worry about the enforcement. So, and in that regard, the security operatives come into the question. Because when you look at these security operatives, even in Lagos, there isn't enough enforcement going on. Oftentimes, when I'm on the road, you know, to do professional work, I'm alarmed at the number of persons, the number of vehicles on the road, the number of young persons playing football, the number of women going up and down, the number of men going up and down. And you keep wondering, is there really a lockdown? Who is enforcing this?
But the other side of the lockdown, if you look at the story beside the photo on the front page of this day, extension of lockdown will fuel unrest, Nigerian Labour Congress wants. Because if you, like I get calls from across the country, person saying that this lockdown is death because things are so difficult. So, yes, on the one hand, it is good to enforce the lockdown, but in the absence of palliative, because you know the story of palliative has been very one-sided. The story of cash transfer has been very lopsided also. So a lot of persons are in their homes, they are hungry, and they may just force their way out. You saw what happened in Sapele at the end of the first 14-day lockdown.
The women trooped onto the streets.
So it is not enough to say, let's enforce, and people are hungry in their homes. They are not getting relief. The state governments are just saying, yes, we have lockdown, we have lockdown. What are you doing to help the people?
The palliative measures certainly are not enough. And the thing is, the palliative measures, no matter what we do, are never going to be enough given our population and given the capacity. Look, for example, when they spoke about the social register, they said that this is a register that can reach, if I'm correct, 3.6 million households
originally
initially.
2.6 million.
And it targets of 11
the
million households.
The president added 1 million.
Yes, so that's 3.6. And a target of 11 million households at the end. What benefits is that to our population? So really and truly, we're going to suffer either way. And that's the unfortunate part, which is why we have to look at the Nigerian solution to the Nigerian problem. Do we open up certain parts of the economy?
Chukwu Ihekwuazu has addressed that. He did, I think, 2 days ago, when he said that the president would need to take a tough decision by Monday, when the lockdown in Ogun State, Lagos, and the Federal Capital Territory for an additional 2 weeks come to an end. Now, what is the decision that the president will have to take? One, will he extend the lockdown in those three areas or do a nationwide lockdown? Two, will he open up certain businesses, right? Or will he decide that the status quo should remain? Now, the problem is, look, when instructions or guidelines are given in this country, nobody respects them.
That's the thing.
Look at the banking sector. After the president's initial broadcast, there was a follow-up by the Minister of Finance and the CBN governor that banks should open, that financial services should be available.
Yes.
Now, go to these banks. Most of them are on complete lockdown.
Yes.
They took the decision on their own that they are not going to open.
Yeah.
And even when people want access to cash, they can't get it. I mean, many of the ATMs, the teller machines, you can't get cash from any ATM. And then antediluvian characters, bushmen like me, who do not do electronic banking, we are put in a very dangerous and terrible situation.
You have to upgrade, Ruben.
No, that will be my number one lesson.
Don't worry. After the lockdown, we'll help you set up
I have to move from the past to the future.
Yes, you just have to. Otherwise, you suffer.
So, there are tough decisions to be made.
Certainly.
I think that the federal government should not look at people's faces. As the president said, this is a matter of life and death.
Yes.
If you all have to be on lockdown, let us be on lockdown. But something should be done about the banks.
Mm-hmm.
They should do their work, even if it is on a skeletal basis. I mean, we journalists, we were placed on the essential service provision. We are doing
our work.
So why are the banks disobeying the president?
Ruben, I don't have that problem. You
are imposing starvation on us.
I've been transferring money to less privileged.
You know you are more modern than me.
Let's look at the Nation newspaper. Yes, the lead story is the same lead story Governor Spoke in interstate lockdown for 2 weeks, but above the masthead, outrage as governor bars reporters from government house. The governor of Abia State is at it again. This time, he said he's barring these journalists for life because they did report on Lassa fever.
Efrain, where are you taking that story?
That's the Nation. That is it up there.
No, that's not the governor of Abia. No. This should be Ebonyi, I think.
Dave Umahi, sorry. Please not check. Abia.
It's not Abia. This must be Ebonyi.
Yes. You see, but...
But just double check to be sure.
Let's double check to be sure which governor we are talking about. Mm. Sorry, it's Ebonyi.
Ebonyi.
Yes.
Dave Umahi.
Outrage as Ebonyi governor... As Governor Umahi bars reporters from government house for life. Because they reported on Lassa fever, which has killed so many people.
Did you say for life?
Yes.
Will he be governor for life?
Ask me if he will be governor for life. So he's just.
He's your governor.
He's overreaching himself as his
exuberance.
You know, and of course, there's outrage. The Nigerian Union of Journalists and Nigerian Guild of Editors are all outraged. And of course, every reasonable Nigerian should be outraged by that kind of action by the
government. It's just not explainable. It's not explainable.
Yes.
Well, I mean, when I read the story, I was outraged. I think that Governor Dave Umahi should be told that the media has a role to play.
Thank you.
Was it not Thomas Jefferson
yes.
who said that he would rather have newspapers mm-hmm. without a country rather than a country without newspapers to stress the importance of the media? And Governor Umahi of Ebonyi State is not in a position to dictate to journalists. He was boasting about not giving them allowance. Now, what does he mean by that? Are they on his payroll? And you know, of course, there are questions to be raised that regard. Because many of our correspondents also, when they go to report in the states, they become appendages of the state government.
Well, the state
so there may be questions about
professionalism. Also pocket journalists.
Yeah.
Perhaps if they fail to pocket you or you refuse to be pocketed, then you become an
enemy.
And
it's a disgraceful habit.
Governors and other power players should be told that they are not in a position to dictate to media houses who they deploy. And I hope that the management of the Sun and the Vanguard will resist the government of Ekiti State. And he's been threatening.
Ebonyi State.
He threatened that those...
That they wouldn't be... They are not safe. They
those journalists cannot, are not safe.
That they cannot guarantee their safety. That in itself is a threat to their
that's
life.
That's a threat. And if anything happens to those two gentlemen, Governor Umahi should be held responsible.
Absolutely, absolutely.
If I owe the media an apology, not for him to be dictating to the Nigerian Union of Journalists,